welcome to this fifth theme in the 2DV604. This focuses on architecture tactics, which are behavior that we design into our systems to address certain quality attributes. So this is the first introduction lecture. And then we have one more lecture in the theme, which is more of a case study where we see tactics at work. So architecture design, we've seen this picture a couple of times. We have the architect and the architect's responsibility during architecture design to design an architecture that enables the architectural significant requirements connected to a stakeholder concern. So we will try to introduce the role of tactics in the architecture design process. The book defines a software tactic or architecture tactic as a design decision that targets a system's response with respect to a certain quality attribute. So a design decision or a set of design decisions that focuses on how the system should respond to certain stimuli in order to achieve certain quality attribute. What a tactic does more in practice is to form a plausible solution for a quality attribute. So the process here is in two steps. First you identify and then you adopt one of these plausible solutions for the achievement of a quality attribute. So tactics forms together with the patterns the strategy an architect develops for a certain concern. So it's important to remember that the concern on the left hand side here is the concern over here is for a given set of stakeholders, but for each concern you will have one or more architecture significant requirements, and each of these requirements will then require decisions, that is tactics, and patterns that structure the architecture elements, and together they form the architecture strategy. And the strategy is exactly what you find in a view. So a view that communicates your decisions with respect to a certain stakeholder concern. So architecture tactics, well, is a complement to reference architectures and architecture patterns. So it is a way to reuse knowledge about these plausible solutions for common problems in architecture design. So coming back to the definition, is a set of design decisions that influences the achievement of a quality attribute response. So the tactics is directly affecting how the system respond to some stimulus. So with the quality attribute scenario picture here, you can see that you have a source of a stimulus, and this can be an event or whatever, and then or an event generator that generates events, and then you have tactics in here that sees to that the artifact, could be the system, in a given environment provides the response within certain constraints that is defined by the architecture's significant requirement. So in order to make this a little bit more concrete, we can look at an example here. So this is a very simple example of a performance tactic. The tactic is focusing on the number of resources we have in a system. So if you look at a client or at the client server system like here, well, what you do is really that you have a number of clients that can access a server at this end. However, in order to manage many requests from many clients, it might be that we have to multiply the available computational power. In this case, install more servers. And each server is running the same piece of software, but in order to manage the incoming traffic and make sure that each client will get the service they request, we put a load balancer in between. And a load balancer takes the traffic and there are different approaches, but evens out the load here and makes sure that no server is overloaded in the server farm on this side. So this is a well-known solution to to performance problems. So, and it's a very nice example of a tactic as such, because it's it provides an unexperienced architect with a plausible solution. In the same way as you had reference architectures and patterns that provided structures for whole systems or parts of systems to address certain challenges, a tactic provides you with a similar support to develop your architecture strategy for a concern and the ASRs belonging to that concern. So it's a straightforward way of getting a head start, so to speak. What's important when it comes to tactics is that you often find options. And these options, even though a tactic focuses on a single quality attribute and how the systems respond to that, there are often various options. And these options, well, give you, well, puts you in a decision situation where you have to make your mind up if you should go for one or the other. So you have often some kind of trade-off situation. And for example, if you look at the load balancer from the previous example, you could have an active-passive load balancer or an active-active one. And active-passive means that you fill up one server with the maximum load before you move on to the next server. So as long as the other servers or server before in the queue is not fully loaded, a server will just stay passive. But you can also have active-active, which means that you have an algorithm that shares the load continuously over the servers in a way that it evens out the load over all servers in the server farm. So here you have two options, some benefits, some drawbacks, and these options, of course, requires that you make a decision. So the decisions you make with respect to a quality attribute, well, forms a strategy for that attribute. What you will see is that your strategy contains the tactics and patterns that structures these tactics. Just to illustrate what this can result in, we can have a look at a modifiability strategy. So modifiability is about controlling the time and cost to implement change. And also that these changes should be tested and deployed. There are some fairly well-known modifiability tactics. For instance, you should localize modifications, which means that you shouldn't have to look everywhere effects of a single modification. So if you change something somewhere, there shouldn't be you shouldn't have to make modifications in too many other places. Another is to prevent ripple effects, which is a variant of the previous one, which is that if you change something at one place, you have to change it at this place and that place and that place. So you have like ripples, ripple effects means that it will be very difficult for you to predict the time and the cost for implementing a change. You can also defer binding time, which is a well-known tactic. But the modifiability stimulus response managed by the tactics is about a change arrives here, and then the response should be that the changes are made, tested, deployed within budget. Budget means time and cost. So let's have a look here at the tactics hierarchy. And you have seen these pictures in the chapters in part two, where you discuss specific quality attributes. What you have here, well, change arrives, and then you have the response over at this end. And if you look at the tactics, you can see that there is a structure here. So you can for modifiability, you have three classes of tactics. You have localized changes, prevention of ripple effects, and defer binding time, the ones that we saw on the previous slide. However, now we come to the options here. So you have options to localize changes. You can, for instance, generalize modules. You can have an abstract common service, and you can limit options, etc. So there are a number of tactics available here that gives you certain options as an architect. You can pick them all, or you can pick some. For prevention of ripple effects, you can use information hiding, and you can make sure that you maintain existing interfaces, or you can use intermediaries to address ripple effects. Deferring binding time, well, configuration files, component replacement, runtime registration, where you dynamically load components. There are a number of tactics available in each class, and there are some benefits and drawbacks with each and every one, of course, and it's up to you as a designer to architect to figure out which ones to use, and that will form your strategy. So the second part here is when you combine tactics and patterns, and that some patterns enables tactics, and there are also patterns that doesn't. They actually make it more difficult to achieve a tactic in the architecture. But what you can see here in this little example, which is the client and load balancer and servers is in fact that, well, what you see here is a client server pattern. So if you had chosen some other type of architecture pattern, it will be a challenge to set up this structure with a load balancer that balances the load on a number of servers. So you have to be careful when selecting tactics and patterns, because sometimes they can work against each other. So the role of tactics and patterns down here is of course that they together form the strategy. The strategy for a number of architectural significant requirements that belong to a concern. So this was the first of two lectures focusing on architectural significant requirements, focusing on architecture tactics, and next lecture is a more case study example of how to use it.